Freeman.
Here.
Counselor Jordan.
Yeah.
Counselor McLaughlin.
Here.
Counselor Pearson.
Here.
And Counselor Reed.
Here. I invite you all to join us for the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
The next item on the agenda, the minutes of the meeting number 12, 1991, held February 11th, 1991, and the minutes of the special meeting number 13, 1991, held February 25th, 1991. Are there any additions or corrections to these minutes?
I move they be accepted as printed.
Second.
All in favor? Opposed? 7-6-0. The next item is citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. Is there anyone from the public who wishes to step forth and make a comment? There being none, we'll close that part of the agenda. And I would like a motion to take something out of order this evening. We have several resolutions we'd like to present this time.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor? This is always the fun part. We always take the first part of the meeting to recognize special achievements in the school side of the town or through special citizens or town employees. I would like to invite former Captain Edward J. Tolan to step forward, please. Captain of the Cape Elizabeth Police Force. The Cape Elizabeth Town Council has this resolution. Whereas Edward J. Tolan served the town of Cape Elizabeth as a patrol officer from 1971 to 1979, as a police sergeant from 79 to 1987, and as the town's first police captain from 1987 to 1991. And whereas he recently departed the Cape Elizabeth Police Department to serve as the chief of police in Gorham, Maine. And whereas Edward J. Tolan served the town of Cape Elizabeth with distinction, not only within his normal course of work, but also through service on community projects and in representing the needs of his fellow department members. And whereas his efforts have enhanced the provision of police services to everyone throughout our community, now, therefore, be it resolved that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, in Town Council assembled, does hereby express our utmost appreciation for all Ed Tolan has done for Cape Elizabeth, and we further wish him his continued success in his new position with the town of Gorham. Congratulations, Chief. And in addition, we have presented Captain Tolan a special chair with the seal of Cape Elizabeth, as our town manager says, emblazoned upon.
Thank you, Phyllis. Members of the council, just to be brief, thank you very much for this resolution. I appreciate the chair that I've already received. It was beautiful, and I will treasure it always as a reminder of my many years here in Cape Elizabeth. I'd just like to say that for all the past council members and everybody I've worked with, were a great help to me in my career. It was tough leaving the good citizens of Cape Elizabeth and working with you folks, but it was a step up in my career. I miss a lot of people here. I miss the guys I worked with. And I would like to say I think the town of Cape Elizabeth is fortunate for two people in particular. One, Mike McGovern, who I enjoyed thoroughly working with and have a great deal of respect for as a town manager, and Dave Pickering, who I think is an excellent police chief, and the town should consider themselves lucky to have him. I thank you very much for everything, and I'm sure I'll be seeing everybody around. Thank you.
Thank you.
Do we have representatives of the high school speech team present? If they come forward, please. Yes, the camera's over here, so if you can just come around. This is impressive. Whereas the Cape Elizabeth High School speech team recently won its 7th consecutive state championship, and whereas each member of the speech team contributed his or her own talents throughout the entire year, and whereas we appreciate the support and supervision Richard Mullen and Terry Gami have provided to these students, now therefore be it resolved that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, in Town Council assembled, does hereby congratulate the state champion Cape Elizabeth speech team, and we thank them for representing our community so well. And it's signed by all the councilors this 13th day of May, 1991. Congratulations. Yes, you may.
Thank you. Thank you again. Particularly in speaking, it's important that we have response. And particularly in this community, we have wonderful response, support for our program. We appreciate the token, but we also appreciate the ongoing support that we get daily for this wonderful program. I thought it might be interesting to let all the students just introduce themselves. There are, I counted quickly, 14 of the 28 who represented the high school at the state finals. But before I do that, I have great support from community volunteers, and Terry Garmy has worked for 5 years. He's very much a teacher at heart, and he has done a wonderful job with, I almost said God. I think there is. I feel that he has some of those proportions. And he's done a wonderful job in helping us in extemp speaking. Terry.
I think saying I have the proportions of God is Dick's way of telling me I'm 10 pounds overweight. It's really been my pleasure and not my obligation. I teach extemporaneous speech and I would have prepared something had I known. But they're absolutely wonderful kids, and the only disadvantage of working with this extemp team is that each male is now taller than I am, and thank goodness for Leah Parker for many reasons. They're wonderful kids, and I have a sense that you will hear from them again, not only as this season concludes and we find out who goes to Chicago to represent the state, because I'm sure many of these students will, but also in the future, because they are simply wonderful kids and very talented, and they're going to do extraordinarily well, and you should be proud of them. Thank you very much for this as well.
So let's have each of them step forward and look right into the camera and introduce themselves, and also perhaps say something of what they do, the various opportunities in speech at Cape Elizabeth High School.
Peter, want to start?
I'm Peter Feilinger. I do foreign extemporaneous speech, and this is my third year doing it. That's Mr. Garmy.
My name is Lindsay Norris, and this is my second year on the speech team. I've spoken in storytelling, humorous interpretation, and...
My name is Sarah Mailman, and this is also my second year of doing speech, and I've done poetry, storytelling, dramatic interpretation, and ensemble.
My name is Mindy Hall. This is my first year doing speech, and I've participated in poetry, dramatic interpretation, and prose.
Hi, my name is Ryan McFall, and I do humorous interpretation and poetry. This is my second year.
Hi, I'm Josh Broussard. This is my third year, and I do DI and prose.
My name is Danny Berman, and I am in original oratory and humorous interpretation.
My name is Jonathan Woodward, and I am active in humorous interpretation, impromptu speaking, and poetry.
I'm Alan Petrillo. This is my fourth year. I've dabbled in impromptu and in ensemble, but am at heart a foreign extemper.
My name is Peter Glasser. This is my fourth year competing in domestic extemporaneous speaking.
Hi, Dan Gelinas. I'm what you call the late bloomer. I feel like really just like a juvenile, a minor amongst all these guys who have been in it for 2 or 4 years. I've been to one speech meet, which happened to be the stage speech meet, and at that speech meet I did impromptu and ensemble. Thanks.
My name's Leah Parker, and I do domestic STEM, and this is my third year.
My name is Regan Maskowitz, and I have done prose and ensemble, and am currently in original oratory, and this is my first year.
Hi, my name is Justin Carradine, and this is the first year, my first year, and I participate in humorous interpretation.
Hi, my name is Rich Bryant. I've had a wonderfully exciting 2-year tour. I've done humorous, dramatic, prose, ensemble, impromptu, and original works. That's what I'm doing.
Hi, my name is Kendall Wyman. I've been with the speech program for 3 years. I've done prose, poetry, dramatic interp, and ensemble.
I'm last. I'm Peter Hand, and this is this is my third year, and I'm a foreign extemper.
And if we were to go on for another half hour, we do have a total of 55 students involved in the program. You've just seen 14 of them. Thanks so much for this recognition.
Half our audience. Could we have one more presentation for the Cape Elizabeth High School boys swim team? And their coach is here to accept the resolution. Coach Don Richards. Whereas the Cape Elizabeth High School boys swim team won the Class A state championship, and whereas Cape Elizabeth ended Bangor's 5-year reign as state champions, whereas the citizens of Cape Elizabeth are proud of these young, dedicated, and talented young men, now therefore let it be resolved that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, in Town Council assembled, does hereby congratulate Coach Don Richards and the boys' Class A swim team champions. Dated this 13th day of May, March 1991, rushing time, at Cape Elizabeth, Maine, signed by all the town councils. Congratulations.
Thank you. First, on behalf of the swimming team, let me thank the council, Mrs. Cogshaw, for all of your support as citizens in the town, and particularly for this resolution. We are most proud of our record. We certainly, along with the speech team, have probably the two largest contingencies of students involved in activities in the school. Between the boys and girls swimming team, we had 61 kids involved this year. We had a runner-up team for the girls and a state championship team for the boys, and we're very, very proud of what those young people can do. I'd like to say, by introducing myself, that my name is Donald Richards and I build champions, but I didn't want to follow the speech team because I don't have 14 people up here to do all of that. Evidently, our season is over and my team has disappeared, so I apologize for their not being here this evening. I'd also like to take a moment to thank our representative, Steve Simons, who last night so graciously presented our team with a proclamation from the state legislature and in front of the school committee, and we were most gratified to receive that as well. So we're very, very pleased. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Reports and correspondence. Any counselors who wish to report on any meetings they've attended or any letters they've received? I have a copy of a letter that was received from a citizen, Mr. James Freilinger, in reference to 1226 Shore Road that he wrote to all of the counselors. I also have a letter from the fourth grade at Montello Elementary School
in Lewiston, Maine, asking that we proclaim March 15th as Maine Day, because Maine will be 171 years old. We will have a resolution that we'll all sign at our workshop tomorrow evening and pass on to the fourth graders. Are there any other? Council McLaughlin.
Thank you. I want to report on my attendance at the February Greater Portland Council of Government meeting. One of the important things that was reported to us at that meeting was that COG has submitted potential legislation entitled An Act to Authorize Municipal Guarantees of Council of Government's Obligations. This is proposed to be emergency legislation, which means it could go into effect quickly rather than going through the waiting period. The statement is guarantees, notwithstanding any law, charter, ordinance provision, or limitation to the contrary, any one or more member municipalities of the council shall have the power to guarantee notes or other indebtedness or obligations of the council. This hopefully will be enacted and will enable the Council of Governments to put forth the guarantee notes from the member communities to help their financial position. There has been some legal questioning of the town's ability to guarantee the kind of notes that we thought we'd already guaranteed. Cape Elizabeth, in fact, has incurred, I believe, some legal fees because of this, and hopefully it will come to be resolved through the legislature. I do have information that I would assume other councilors received about an orientation workshop for public officials, for zoning board and planning board members. Certainly councilors are also welcome at those, and I hope some of our board members will take the opportunity to attend those. And one of the, I just wanted to speak to something that we received in our packets that I'm absolutely delighted to have seen, is the setting of committee goals by a number of our town volunteer committees. I know this is something we've talked about when we do our we've done the orientation evening the past couple of springs, and I, for one, am very glad to see these coming forth. I commend the committees who have taken this action so far. Hopefully others will follow in their step, and it'll help them organize their actions for the next year. Thank you.
Anyone else? Okay, next Thursday evening, March 21st, there will be the orientation for the boards and commissions members. That'll be here in the town council chambers, and I believe it'll also be televised. Mrs. Pizzo, do you have anything to report as far as town hall news?
Yes. Just a reminder that nomination papers are available for town council and school board. There are positions open on both the school board and the council. If anyone would like further information, please come see me at town hall. The deadline is Tuesday, April 2nd. I believe to date no one has taken out papers for the two-year town council position. So again, if you'd like any more information on the council or school board positions, please give us a call.
Council McLaughlin.
Thank you. I'm sorry, I did have one more item. The Council Ordinance Committee will be meeting next Monday, the 18th. One of the items on our agenda will be discussion of the wetlands ordinance. This is something when Councilor Creelman was chairman of the Ordinance Committee last year, promised to citizens that we would do that kind of revisit. We're planning to do it. If any citizens have any comments about the wetlands ordinance, I would ask that you make those comments known to any of these three councilors who are on the ordinance committee or through town hall. Thank you.
There being no other reports and correspondence, we'll move on to our public hearing, the proposed signed ordinance. And I'll ask Council McLaughlin, as chairman of the ordinance committee, to give us the background, please.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. I feel we've given this so often. I should at least have it memorized, and I certainly don't. But I would like to read the purpose statement of this proposed new chapter in our Code of Ordinances regarding signs. Purpose being, the purpose of this ordinance is to govern the placement and maintenance of signs, promote signs in keeping with the town character, discourage excessive signs by minimizing the number and size of signs, eliminate intrusive sign lighting, and encourage structurally sound and well-maintained signs in the interest of the health, safety, and general welfare of the residents of Cape Elizabeth. I want to thank all the people who have worked to make this, to bring the sign ordinance to where it is this evening for a public hearing. The planning board has certainly had some good input about this ordinance. We've had input from citizens at the first public hearing that we had last fall. The current town planner, Maureen O'Meara, the previous town planner, Steve Butler, and the manager have been good staff people working on this to help get the ordinance committee to where we are today, finally, with the sign ordinance presented to the public hearing. I think some of the good, very good things about this sign ordinance are the facts that it puts all of the language about signs in one chapter of the ordinance book. As somebody who works with ordinance books on a daily basis, I can't begin to tell you how important it is and how much easier it is if you have all that language in one place. It makes it easier both for the people who work as town staff as well as for people coming forward trying to figure out what they need to do to make their signs conforming with the town ordinances. As I said last month, perhaps one of the best pieces of news in this ordinance is what will be called a grandfathering clause that says any permanent sign not conforming with the standards of this ordinance at the time of its enactment may continue until such time that any substantial change other than normal maintenance is made to the sign. And I think that's all I need to say about this evening. I'd be very glad to respond to questions.
Is there anyone who'd like to step forward and make a comment? This is the public part of the hearing. If you come to the microphone, please, and give us your name and address.
Greg Jones, 298 Ocean House Road. Followed the ordinance as it unfolded, since I perhaps have the most signs in town. And I'd like to express my appreciation to the board for paying attention to my concerns as I've voiced them over the past several months. I feel one final change is warranted. I feel that since any and all signs are going to be added into the maximum square footage, including the on-premises informational signs as defined in section 2112, I feel that for gas stations the maximum should be increased from 250 to 300 square feet. Our business was used as a case study, I think, for this purpose, and the figures show that we have approximately 288 square feet currently, but of that, 27 is of the directional type nature. In addition to, there are several more signs that are required by either federal or state law, as well as insurance regulations. So it seems to me that since there's only three gas stations in town anyways, that it might be appropriate to increase the maximum square footage from 250 to 300, and I would hope that the council might see fit to do so. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone else who wishes to step forward? There being no one, we'll close the public hearing, and we'll go on to item number 150 to consider a proposed sign ordinance and take any necessary action. Do you have comments from councilors? Councilor Reed.
Yes, to Councilor McLaughlin for the chair. Were those measurements that were done, Councilor McLaughlin, under 300 square feet, do you recall, on the mobile station?
At the mobile station, Mr. Jones is accurate when he says it was about 288 square feet. The town planner and I measured every sign on his property.
Those are the ladies' room signs, men room signs.
Yeah, we included those. Some of those are two-sided. You know, I've just all added in there.
Well, I would like to commend the committee for this sign ordinance because I've seen it really show the people of Cape Elizabeth we do listen. But under section 21-4-3, subsection B, 2B, I would like to have further discussion on that 250 square foot and if that could be increased to 300.
Madam Chairman.
Councilor Jordan.
I went over that and I went over to the station, went over it, and I feel that there might be another way that this could be handled because some of those signs are federal and state required that they list it out. And if you take a gas, you take the gas pumps at that one station, there's four sets of pumps there. And so at you run into eight signs says regular gas, eight for special, eight for super special, and then you've got the octane, which is 87, 89, and 93, and then you've got the prices above that. And I just feel that those shouldn't be added into what we figure the sign ordinance is for. The sign ordinance, in my opinion, and I'm sorry to bring this out late to the committee because it's something that maybe we should have thought of while we was working on it, but I'm kind of slow at times and I have to think things over two or three times probably to get it clear in my mind. So I would like to, when we get ready to vote on this, propose an amendment to it, that to section 21-4-3B. And would read, except that signs required by federal, state, and local regulations for safety and consumer reasons shall not be included in the calculation of total sign area. And I think that would take care of that section B in my opinion, because some of those signs that they have to have them up there as a state and federal and a safety requirement. And I don't think we should be including those signs in our ordinance. We're looking for these that are set out by the street, you might say, for temporary with a special on some oil or some antifreeze or things like that. That can be over, they can overdo that. And I would like to see us discuss that a little bit.
Okay, so did you propose an amendment?
Well, I think we've got another guy over there I'd like to.
I was just gonna say, Madam Chairman, I agree with the context of the amendment, but I think that it might be more prudent to put it into section 21-2-1, which is signs allowed in all zones without a permit, because there may be other businesses that might have signs that are required by law. Not saying offhand that I know of any, but just to alleviate that, otherwise you'd have to go through every zone and change it. You've already got traffic control signs or devices, and that may be amended or added to say, or any signs required by law, state, local, whatever. I don't know if that would work in that wording, but I think it should be more of a blanket than just specifically one specific area.
Comments?
I think that has some merit. My concern, I think, somebody else's concern might be that wouldn't, the way the language is under the sign standards for gas stations, that still would not allow them to have more than 250 square feet if we did that. It just said that they don't need a permit for those federally and state mandated signs. Okay. What I'm hearing right now is a desire to either to take that those kinds of signs out of the square footage limitation or to put them in and increase the square footage amount. What I would like to know, Councilor Jordan, I didn't bring with me, and I'm sorry, the very complete list that Maureen O'Meara and I came up with of the square footage of each sign. And I don't know from the language in your proposed amendment how many square feet those signs account for in a typical gas station. That's something I would really like to know before I need to do some of that slow thinking. Okay. I'll do it quickly if I can.
I just want to say why I didn't recommend the change, the 250 square feet, because that station that we use, to go by and come up with the number of square footage as far as sign goes, had 288. Mm-hmm. So I just took a rough calculation of 30 square feet of those odds and ends signs that are required by state and federal law.
Mr. McGovern?
I discussed that with the town planner this afternoon, and you know, while we didn't look at every federal, state, and local regulation and try to figure out which sign was there as a result of a requirement, it was her feeling that it was in the range of only about 10 to 20 square feet of the signs that are presently at the typical station would fall within this provision. Depending on the size of the signs utilized to provide that information.
Just one more thing, if I may, Madam Chairman. Is it possible to put that into the special sign standards 21-4-3 criteria to just say that signs required by state federal laws will not be included in any square footage requirements in any of the preceding or, you know, I think there's a way to blanket that somehow. I don't think that just saying gas stations because it may be in another sign zone. So possibly under special sign standards, the following does not apply to figure and square footage in any other criterion, any other sections. I don't know how the best way to word that, but I think that would give you a better avenue to introduce that special sign standards.
I think that perhaps this, since we're coming from two different places, that it might be best to do one of two things. Move on with the sign ordinance as presented and recommend that the ordinance committee study this type of amendment and where it would be best placed, because probably it's not going to apply just to gas stations. I mean, restaurants have certain requirements that are set up by town or state ordinances for safety reasons, or wait and have another. We would have to have a separate hearing on the amendment anyway. We wouldn't.
It's not really a substantive change.
Okay, so we could do that, or we could wait and have you work on it and come back with the amendment in a designated place at another month.
That would be my recommendation, that we refer this back to the ordinance committee and we review it and get it in the proper place and bring it back before the council. And Bobby, would require a public hearing, or you don't think so?
Michael doesn't seem to think so, but well, I think it has the potential for being more substantive than.
If you send it back to the committee, then you kick in the hearing process again. One of the problems we have is in the current signed ordinance is so poor to interpret. You know, it'd be unfortunate for just one minor issue if you didn't either try to deal with it or, you know, in some fashion. Because this, you know, it might be easier to try to amend this tonight than to, and to maybe relook at it again rather than to continue with our signed ordinance in its current form.
Councilor Creelman had his hand up. Excuse me. I'm looking at you, Carl.
I'm confused.
Pearson, you know, I can see why.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I was going to say, the one final ditch effort where there's only, I think, four different zones or four different areas, shopping centers, et cetera, would it be possible just to add that one to each of the particular zones or parameters, including gas station, shopping center? That would just be one line added to all.
Councilor McLaughlin.
A concern I would have with that approach is that we don't know what size of signs might be required by the state and federal regulations. As the manager pointed out, that they may only, I don't know. This is one of the things I don't know right now that I feel I need some more time to find out about. If a state regulation tells you what information you must have on your sign, I'm not sure if it tells you how big or how small that sign could be. I would, you know, if we want to consider amending it tonight, I would rather keep a square footage max limit for the signs in a gas station. I'm wondering what the procedure is if we proceed we've had our public hearing on this, proceed to perhaps pass the ordinance as it stands tonight and then come back with an amendment from the ordinance committee?
I think that probably that would be a better approach, and that really this has just been dropped in our laps here this evening, and we really should think about it, because we don't know how many square feet it could ultimately be. And I think it takes a little more thought than just off the cuff.
I always like to throw wrinkles now and then, so I'm sorry that I confused you all, but I thought it made quite a lot of sense after I went through and looked the station over and looked at the signs and what have you. And at the time when they come in, and after Janet and Maureen measured all these little signs, I was disgusted when they even had the men's room and the ladies' room, because I thought you should separate them and not require a station take that sign down so we could put up one of his own signs, so that I wouldn't know which one to go into. So I think we've carried this too far, and that's why I come in with that tonight. And I feel we should work on it and go back and start over again.
I'm wondering how much of a hardship those signs really do create. I mean, having to have them there as part of your total square footage.
I don't think they require any hardship, or there is any hardship, because these that I've talked about, you can't see them until you drive up to the pump.
Mm-hmm. Well, I can motion on this item here.
Madam Chairman?
Yes.
I would move that the town council approve as written Chapter 21 of the Code of Ordinances, the sign ordinance, with the provision that the ordinance committee review the proposed amendment language presented by Councilor Jordan tonight, taking into account council discussion, and report back to the council within 2 months on proposed amendments.
Second.
Discussion? There being none, all those in favor? Opposed? 6-1. Item number 151, to consider a progress report from the School Space Study Committee and take any necessary action. I believe we have in your packet the progress report from Chairman Jeffrey White. Mr. White, would you like to make any comments to us?
Just briefly, the report, I think, speaks for itself. There are two things that I would like to address. First, I'd be happy to answer on behalf of the committee, and there's another member here with me who is available also, any questions that you might have. Secondly, I'd like to specifically address that portion of the report which requests funding for an architectural and engineering study primarily of the middle school building. We have concluded that in terms of long-term planning for some anticipated population growth at all levels, but particularly in the middle school, that we think it's important for the town to look at the long-term conditions of the school, the limitations of it, and other matters that are dealt with in the report. While it may be possible to defer that, the committee is generally of the view that if we are going to make sensible, rational, considered recommendations to the council and to the school board, that job ought to be undertaken now and considered by us as part of our work, so that we can make recommendations for your consideration. My understanding is that some funds for that purpose have been included in the budget submitted by the school department, the school board, and I know the budget process is an ongoing one now, but my hope is that those funds can be made available. I believe that process would involve a definition of a scope of the work and also probably competitive bidding under the appropriate state statute. If there are any questions at the appropriate time, I'd be happy to respond to any of them.
Questions from members of the council? Councilor Reed.
Yes, Mr. White. My concern is that the work not begin until after the fiscal year changes July 1. I would prefer to see the work or discussion of seeing the work start immediately on that study. Has that been discussed in committee?
The relationship of the fiscal year to the work has not been discussed. It's our view that we are under an obligation, as things currently stand, to report back to the council and the school board by July 1. Our hope would be that we can, if the money were approved for this purpose, is to get the gears in motion as soon as possible, to retain architectural engineering consultants as soon as possible, and if possible, to integrate their conclusions into our final report. That may be cutting it awfully close, but that is a preference, and I think is our recommendation.
Thank you. Questions from any other counselors? Councilor Krillman.
Yes, Mr. White, in your report to us, you had indicated that budgetary-wise, there'd be a cost between $10,000 and $20,000. The Press Herald was more specific this morning, mentioning $15,000 on the dot. Is that figured into the school budget that's in tentative form right now? Is there a particular line that I can find that on? Maybe the superintendent?
I believe the superintendent can probably address that better than I.
Sure.
Sure.
Thank you. I would also like to take this opportunity to thank Mr. White and the members of that committee. It's been certainly very helpful. And it is a very needed and necessary bridging, I think, of your concerns and the school committee's concerns, school board's concerns. We have sort of taken a step to move the process forward. In our budget discussions last week, we did try to rearrange our numbers. We'll be going into this a little bit in more detail with our workshop with you tomorrow. But we have put that line as a separate line in our proposed budget. And we simply took a kind of median figure in order to have it there, and that was why the $15,000 figure was mentioned in the article.
Thank you. We'll just defer that about 24 hours.
I do hope, I would say, I would like to speak up too, is the needs in that building are extensive. For instance, in a rainstorm we had a week or so ago, rain really seeps in now quite badly through some of the window wall curtains. You don't have a good shot at repairing those 60s buildings' window walls. They, generally speaking, require pretty extensive wall work. You don't just put a new window in and that sort of thing. So we are seeing, in many ways, a variety of issues that are like watching a building sort of deteriorate in front of your eyes. And so I think this is the time to get started with the study. I recognize that the study is going to come back with costs that are going to be a difficult issue for the community, but the sooner we have some definite information to share, make some long-range plans, hopefully shorter than long-range, at least we'll know what we're dealing with.
Thank you. Councilor Jordan.
Yes, I want to thank the committee. I think this is a very good report, and I read it over, and I think they went into the schools and done an excellent job. Do you think the $15,000 is going to do the job?
Well,
quite
you get what
close?
You know, to some degree, that's a matter of defining the scope of the work and dealing through a process that the state does lay out as a fairly clear process. You have to do some advertising, et cetera, et cetera. And obviously you get somebody in there and define the scope and try to figure out how much you need. That we have reason to believe, and maybe Mr. White would like to explain what he's done in this, would be a median figure. To some degree, obviously, that's not going to give us a thorough handle on every single problem, but it is a sort of ballpark figure.
Now, this is all got to be done with town funds, there's no state funds when we get into construction or anything?
No. The state construction process is really a long and complicated process and is very much tied to the amount of subsidy that a particular town gets. In other words, if we decide as part of this process to apply for state funding for construction, we will certainly not see anything in excess of the 27% thereabouts that we are receiving in subsidy. And it's a highly competitive process. One has to has a once-a-year opportunity to apply for funds, and when you come to actual renovation, there are many areas that state funds will not cover at all. You have to be able to justify, according to a fairly complicated list of needs, what it is you're trying to accomplish through a renovation project. If it is a space need, there is some hope, of course, of getting some money through the state construction project. That will be an issue we will be looking into, but there are many reasons why that is long, complicated. Sometimes it is a competitive process. You might be rated 20th on a list of 20, and no guarantee of ever getting anything because you're competing throughout the state for needs. And if it is funded through the state construction process, you would not be getting 100% funding anyway. You would be getting funding tied to the percentage of subsidy in the district.
Now, if I may, one more question. Now, would the work that they're doing here in this study be in line in case you wanted to go for some state funding? Or would
well,
we have to go back?
As a matter of fact, it's been my experience that the state now is either requiring or at least strongly urging that towns do this kind of study before they get into a conceptual phase. Back along, you could pretty much in-house come up with a need and a need statement that you didn't have to back with specific pre-planning. However, now, and perhaps Councilor Amaral is a little more up on the exact regulation, but they either are requiring it or at least strongly urging it so that it is consistent with what the state is looking for.
Thank you.
Councilor Amaral.
Yeah, just a couple of comments. There is a new state program. I'm not sure if you're familiar with it, Connie, but it's an effort to replace portable classroom units, and it is undersubscribed, which means that anyone who has applied this year is getting the money. So,
what's the limit on that?
Well, it depends on the project.
Okay. It's worth looking into.
The total limit is 10% of what is available in state funds for school construction, but there's no individual limit on a particular project.
Okay.
So well, that's something we ought to really look into.
Definitely, because we do have portables that we are looking to replace, and we knew we had an obligation to go back to the state with an update on where we were. But again, replacing those portables is really tied to an understanding of the overall needs of the middle school. That's a critical piece that we must have, is some conceptual sense of what we want to do with that building, to say nothing of what its critical mechanical and infrastructure problems are.
Councilor Amaral.
Yeah, just a couple of follow-up questions. The study that you're proposing is more of a structural infrastructure type of study than what the NASDAQ report was that we had done a couple of years ago.
Yes, this, what in looking at what had been what planning had been done, it was obvious to us that there had been a lot of talk about space needs. That is, we have the enrollment projections and how many classrooms do we need for certain years and so forth, but we could find, nor could I find in discussing with staff, any analysis from the standpoint of hiring somebody to come in and help us get an overview of what are mechanical, structural, electrical, you know, the various infrastructure kinds of things in that building, to say nothing of a conceptual overview of how that building could be modified to meet our program needs. That's a very important piece. So that means, however, this is sometimes called a master plan. It's called various things by various architectural firms, and they are doing it for a number of school districts. There are firms that are experienced in doing this, so they understand to some degree what the state requirements are and so on. So it is a step that would be useful.
Just one last thing.
Oh, surely.
The report, the School Space Study Committee report dated February 19th, is an excellent report, but I just wanted to question one item on page 5. which is the in the section 7, the second paragraph, it starts with the high school currently serves approximately 450 high school students.
Yes.
Then it goes on to say the high school building was designed to accommodate approximately 750 students.
Yes.
If I remember right, and Bill would know, he was on the building committee, it was at least, it was supposed to accommodate at least 1,000, if not 1,100 students.
We will review that in detail before our final report is submitted. Please take into account, although I hope that the perception is this is fairly meaty, that we are just partway through the process, and all of this, while I think is going to stand the test of time, is preliminary and is largely informational. But thank you for your correction.
Councilor Jordan.
You sound so disgusted if I speak again.
No, I just saw you wagging your finger.
You try to keep his hand down.
She tried to keep me from saying anything more. But Councilor Elmore was right. At the time that school was constructed, there was the idea that it could handle 1,000 students. And I noticed you probably have a lot different programs nowadays than when we discussed it at that time, which was back in 1968-9. But one other thing to you, Connie, is you mentioned the portables. You got to start thinking about fixing them or replacing them or doing some work on them. You know, you've been here 2 or 3 years.
Well, we ran into, in checking all the roof situations, which was a necessary follow-up to the fall situation, once we asked the structural engineers to check all roofs, we included the portable structures at that time, and the results we have back from that check have alerted us to the fact since those portables were attached to buildings, they kick into a different set of codes and snow load, which means we are now under the obligation to go under them and put more structure underneath them and make some other modifications, but that's essentially what it is.
Thank you. I appreciate it. I won't go back into the history.
Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you. Mr. White, I've got a couple of questions. One statement in the report on page 3 when you're discussing the middle school, number 7 towards the top of the page says handicapped access is barely adequate. Is that in a specific part of the building? I know a lot of work has been done in that building to make it handicapped accessible.
I believe it is considered handicapped accessible. There is one place in the oldest part of the building where there is a elevator type of operation, for lack of better words, which is in a stairway, which is not the most efficient way in terms of moving people to provide movement up to the second floor. There's access outside of that same building on a long, I think recently constructed asphalt pathway that is perhaps not ideal. Our feeling is that while there is access to the building, that's something that ought to be looked at as an overall consideration in terms of future use and planning.
Yeah, I guess it was the terminology used that caught my attention. I thought we'd done a lot of work for the amount of money we put in that building. I hate to see it described as barely adequate.
I'm sorry. I really feel I have an obligation to add to that, if I might. I've had a call.
I think that is a proper term, and in fact, that may even be overstating the case a little bit. We have enormous problems in that area. We have very few students who have specialized needs in that area, but with the students that we do see and have, and in spite of very earnest attempts to make that building work, we have a number of problems that crop up, and they are just very difficult to take care of. We have also been checking the codes on the high school, which unfortunately 20 years ago, although there were attempts at that time to make it handicap accessible, do not meet current code in that area. So we, and part of our discussion was to alert the town council and the town to realize that in spite of efforts, we haven't made it.
Thank you. Mr. White, I'm curious about some of the underlying assumptions that your committee apparently is working under.
Mm-hmm.
And I just want these put up on the table.
Sure.
Is it the committee's assumption that the middle school will continue to house grades 4 through 8 and the program needs of those grades?
We haven't arrived at a conclusion concerning that. There is considerable excess space at the high school, and whether or not needs that are currently met by space at the middle school could be met by the high school, for instance, moving the eighth grade, which has been considered in the past, is something to look at. So we haven't made any final assumption about that. If, however, it continues to be configured the way that it is in terms of the grade levels that are in that building, it's going to be seeing in the next 5 to 10 years another 150 students, which is obviously the problem.
Right. Those are the figures I was looking at, and you're looking at between 5 and 7.5 additional classrooms if you continue to house those grades
That's
in
right.
that building.
That's right.
What I would hope and encourage the committee to do is do some real creative thinking about different ways to use all of the school space that's available. Do some really, be wild for a little bit, please, and say,
sure.
Well, we've had kindergarten in the high school. You talk to this year's eighth graders and this year's ninth graders, and they'll tell you they've done, everything's happened to those classes. And I'm sure Councilor Reed has heard this from somebody in her household. And don't discount other ways of assembling the grade levels besides what we have right now. I know the school system has gone through a lot of discussion about the middle school concept, and some people are very firmly committed to that. I don't want that if that concept is going to drive the space study report, I want that stated up front.
No, I don't think it is. In fact, what I contemplate is we may well come back in our final report with the alternative configurations as to where classes at one end of the spectrum might go alternatively from where they are now, driven by what we have, the costs of providing alternate space, and all of those kinds of considerations. In my mind, that's an open issue, and there aren't any pre-existing assumptions on those structural issues relating to what grades are where.
And do you have any feel for this may be a very unfair question. Do you have any feel for comparative costs of perhaps demolishing part of the existing middle school and starting from scratch as opposed to repairing what's there now?
No, not at all. And one of the reasons why we think it's so important to have some professional help to study that and give us some guidance on it is because we need those kind of assessments in order to adequately look at the medium and long term of what our buildings are and what they're going to be capable of doing. We don't. That's one of the things I would hope to get a general assessment of in a study, particularly of the middle school.
Okay, thank you.
Anyone else? Well, thank you, Mr. White.
You
and your committee have done an excellent job so far. We look forward to your final report.
Thank you very much.
May I have a motion on this item, please, for acceptance, receipt of the report? Councilor Reed.
Madam Chairman, I move that we accept the progress report of the Cape Elizabeth School Space Study Committee dated February
19th, 1991. Second.
All in favor? This acceptance meaning receipt, not endorsement,
no,
right?
Did I say accept? Would you prefer
accept.
I say
receipt? Receipt, I think, if you don't mind.
Excuse me.
Would you amend so?
I will amend to.
All those
receipt.
In favor? Okay. Item number 152, to consider a report from the Ordinance Committee regarding health fitness facilities and take any necessary action. I'll again turn to Councilor McLaughlin, the Chairman of the Ordinance Committee.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. Councilor Jordan's telling me I've got too many notes. That's how I keep track of where I am. Just want to give the council a quick chronology of the health fitness facility zone text change. This came before, a request to this effect came to the council last fall, and at our October meeting, we referred the text amendment to the planning board. This came back to the council last month and was referred to the ordinance committee. The tongue's gone already. The ordinance committee did meet after our regular council meeting last month and had a good discussion about it. It had a number of concerns, two primary concerns about specifically the BA zone, which is where the health facility text is proposing to allow health facilities. The concerns are based on the 100-foot front yard setback. That means that a building can be no closer than 100 feet to the right-of-way unless you apply for and successfully receive a variance from the zoning board. We're concerned about that deepest setback, especially in the BA zone, which encompasses most of what we consider the town center. This would leave a considerable area in front of a building that could be used for parking. We're looking at this, thinking about our comprehensive plan and what we want to see in our town center. Anything built there now is going to outlive all of us. And this, just so that we stay aware that there are long-term ramifications of what happens in the town center. We're also concerned about maintaining some continuity of the existing building line in the town center on both sides of the streets. And that existing line now ranges from 35 to 140 feet setback from Route 77. Based on those concerns, we said we, the ordinance committee, would ask the council to refer back to the planning board a chance to revisit this text amendment and specifically look at the setback issue. The planning board did that last week, I think. Is it last week? Last week in a workshop session, which I did attend. The planning board decided that it does not want to deal with the town center, which may become with what may become a potential town center zone, in a piecemeal fashion, looking at setbacks in the next 2 or 3 months and later on looking at other aspects of the town center. As somebody who deals with this kind of issue on a daily professional basis, I think they made a very good planning decision. I did say to them, we might want to change one of the provisions in the proposed ordinance that right now is allowing. Right now there's a provision that says there will be a 15-foot no parking area in the front yard. So the 15 feet closest to the right-of-way would not be allowed to have parking. My proposal to the planning board was, how do you feel about increasing that no parking dimension to 30 feet, thinking that 15 feet of no parking along Route 77 in the BA zone doesn't give you room to do an awful lot of vegetative screening, which is what I think we had in mind, to see some shrubbery, some trees there. What I heard from the planning board was that they had no real strong feelings about the 15 feet or 30 feet or anything else in that range, but they really did not want to get into the building setback issue. I've talked with the tree warden about this and asked his opinion on how deep a buffer strip do you really need to give a canopy tree like an oak or a maple or an elm, a real street tree, a real tree, a good fighting chance for more than a 10-year survival rate, which is what they basically say for street trees now. His response was you need 25 to 30 feet back from the road for that. Having said all that, and I've discussed this with Councillor Jordan, he being the only other member of the ordinance committee who was immediately available in the past couple of days, so we've done some thinking about this in the past couple of days. And I hate to try to have ordinance committee meetings at a regular council meeting. So I'll go through the terminology of the draft here, but I would like the councilors to be thinking about increasing that front yard no parking setback to 30 feet rather than leaving it at 15 feet. We could do that in a change tonight if you want to set this to public hearing next month, or we could take it back to the ordinance committee and see if there are any other ramifications that we want to consider with this. With that very long introduction, the text being proposed right now deals with the building, gives a definition for building height, which is always a good thing to have in the Code of Ordinances, deals with parking specific to a recreational facility, and gives definitions for athletic facility and recreational facility. It also deals with building bulk for a recreational facility in the BA zone. The proposed definition for recreational facility is a facility designed, equipped, and programmed for indoor athletics, physical fitness training, health education, and community recreation activities. Ancillary uses may include child care for users on the premises, vending machines, probably those lighted Coke machines.
That's right.
Physical fitness counseling and education. Other uses shall comply with all applicable codes and ordinances. The proposed building maximum building height in the Business A district would be 35 feet, which is comparable to a number of the existing buildings in the district, such as the front building at the Millwork and the Town Hall would be two of the higher buildings in the existing BA. For parking requirements would be one parking space per 250 square feet or major fraction thereof, a floor area of an athletic or recreational facility. Listed as a permitted use in the BA district would be recreational facility subject to the following requirements. The building footprint shall be limited to 12,000 square feet or 25% of the lot size, whichever is larger. No parking shall be located in the front setback within 15 feet of the right-of-way. Building exterior materials shall vary in texture and design. The project shall include plans for safe pedestrian circulation to nearby commercial and recreational areas and adjacent neighborhoods. I'd also like to point out that I received here this evening a letter, the subject of which, a letter from Sue Weatherby, the director of our community services program, the subject of it being proposed fitness center and gymnasium. There has been quite a bit of talk about, well, good, the town's finally going to be given a gym. I think everybody needs to stay aware that the town's not going to be given anything flat out, and that's my understanding from somebody who has an interest in setting up this kind of facility. There will be financial arrangements made, and I'm sure that those will be, those can be presented. But I don't want people laboring under the misconception, perhaps, that this automatically is going to be a gymnasium. That it's a possibility. We've all heard about it, I think. I know how valuable gym space is in this town, and I know the need for it. But I don't want people to think this is automatically going to be an outcome if we draft this, if we have this kind of language accepted. Thank you. They're getting restless.
Okay. Comments from councilors? Councilor Reed?
I would like to reiterate a comment I made in workshop about my understanding of the New England town center concept and the town center concept that we want for Cape Elizabeth, we being the community. I just would like to think through how long that process may take to define, and again, what impact that will have on the proposal that has been made by Mr. Tinsman.
I think we've got to be very careful that we divorce a particular project from an ordinance text, and that by having this letter here tonight sort of starts to mingle them. What we're really talking about is the effect this particular ordinance text will have on the town center, and not necessarily what anyone is proposing to construct
I'm sorry, I'm not a member of the ordinance committee. I didn't understand that clear delineation. I'm sorry.
So we should try not to talk about any particular project in this context, because we're not the planning board. Did you want to say something, Mr. Tinsman?
Yes, I would. First of all, I'd like to thank you for considering my request for a health fitness facility in a BA zone in Cape Elizabeth. It's been a long process. This particular process did start last fall with the council and then went back to the planning board and had various planning board meetings and workshops and excuse me, worked very hard with the planning board on coming up with the restrictions and the qualifications that a facility like this would have. I would like to remind you, though, that this whole process started back in 89 when I purchased the property. The property that I currently own is, of course, where I'm will be coming back hopefully someday with a proposal to put a facility like this if it's accepted. But it has been a long process, and part of the reason for the long process has been that the current ordinance was drafted so long ago that it does not address this type of facility. What I am hearing here is back and forth a lot of times that, and the planning board made this very clear, and I just heard you say this also, that this is not a specific proposal before you. It is a request to allow health fitness facilities in a BA zone in Cape Elizabeth. Cape Elizabeth is the only town in Greater Portland that I know of that does not have this type of facility. It is a type of facility that will increase the quality of life in Cape Elizabeth. I feel that in going around the town, I see a lot of people. I'm very fortunate not only to live in town here, but to work in town and own a business here in town. But the general sense that I get is that there's a real craving for this type of facility in this town. I'm not going to call it a gym. I'm not going to call it a fitness center. I'm not going to call it anything until it is able to be an accepted use and come back for site plan review. That is the planning board's process, not here. But I would like to stress the fact that it has been a number of meetings with the planning board. They've reviewed every which way, considered all the things such as parking, setbacks, building heights, the style of buildings. They've considered everything that's within the current ordinance, and what I sense is that they have concluded that we currently have standards for all these things. We have standards for setbacks. We have standards for height. We also have a site plan review, which goes into a lot of detail on a lot of items such as this. So in terms of coming up with any further restrictions, it has been recommended by the planning board to consider the proposal before you. I had the sense that at the ordinance committee meeting that it was also going to be recommended, and then we started talking about the setbacks issue. From what I understand, the town council voted on the setbacks last meeting and voted for a 100-foot setback. It's not something that I'm involved with. It's not something I had anything to do with. It was a 100-foot setback when I bought the property. It is currently a 100-foot setback. I have room on my property to build a building within all the setbacks. The size of the building will be determined by the amount of parking that's allowed. We've had a recommendation from the town engineer as to what that parking should be, as well as the planning board. And I think what I would like to request is that the council consider the request before you to put it to a public hearing. Let's hear what the town people have to say about my request. I welcome that. I've heard a lot of public comments about this type of use, not specifically where it might be or what it's going to be, but the fact that it is something that will increase the quality of life, no matter where it is. If it's in a BA zone.
Mr. Tinsman, though, you keep saying my request and my project. And
that's
I think
right. No, I didn't say my project. My request to include a health fitness facility in a BA zone, wherever it is.
In my facility. I'd kind of like to keep
divorced
as we can.
That's right.
Right.
My request. I would like the council to consider my request.
Your request
for a health fitness facility. Not my facility, a health fitness facility, to be included in the BA zone.
Let's not get into an argument over it. Let's just say to consider this ordinance proposed before us, which allows a health care or a health facility in a BA zone.
Well, I guess that's what I'm trying to say.
I think because people are getting confused. They really are. So I just think it's a point of clarification.
Well, that's part of the reason I wanted to step up here and say some things because, you know, I was completely at ease with the way the planning board went about this process. There were some frustrations in there, but we bounced some things back and forth, and I believe that what they've come up with for a recommendation is a good one for the town.
Okay.
And I'm not here to say my facility. I think this type of facility is good for the town. I've seen it in other towns. Every town around us has them, and I think they're good. And I would like to request that you put it out to public hearing and see what the people have to say.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Councilor Jordan.
Yes, I'd just like to say that in what Councilor McLaughlin was saying about the 15 and the 30 feet, I think I agree with that 100%, and I'd like to see that change to 30 feet. If you're going to have any trees, shrubbery, or any green growth of any sort, you've got to have more than 15 feet to have good trees and what have you to grow. So I would like to see us change that to 30 feet.
Councilor Creelman.
As I was out of town on town business and Councilor McLaughlin did not get to me, I would also like to echo Mr. Jordan's agreement on the 30-foot setback with respect to the no parking area, section 19.2-4.2.
How do you feel this is going to fit into the concept of the town zone, town center zone? That's
one advantage
what you're discussing
of
for.
Increasing this from 15 to 30 feet is that you're not going to have parking as close to the road as you could otherwise with this kind of facility. Let us say that. So in terms of that, it may be seen perhaps as an interim measure, and when the planning board does look more fully, as we're hoping they will, at a town center zone, this could change. But I think even if this does change, what I would foresee happening, and if they come up with zoning for a more traditional New England village, is the buildings are closer to the street. We're going to see the buildings coming to perhaps within 40 feet of the street. You don't do any parking between that 30-foot and the 40-foot. That leaves you 10 feet. You'd be hard-pressed to get a one-way driveway in that 10-foot strip. So I think this kind of proposal to increase it to 30 feet of no parking will fit quite harmoniously with what we are apt to see for a town center zone, and have discussed that with the town planner, and that those are her words, actually.
Okay.
I'm not going to put them forth as mine.
Councilor Pearson.
Madam Chairman, I'm confused. I thought that in the workshop, maybe I was out in left field, that we were discussing the actual building setbacks.
You're not confused.
Well, then here it doesn't even say building setbacks at all. It just says parking setbacks.
That's right.
What's the difference?
A building setback is how far the building has to
exactly.
be from the right-of-way.
Right.
This no parking strip would be 15 or 30, whatever, feet closest to the right-of-way where you could not have any paved parking area. But your building would still be 100 feet back. You would have parking starting 15 or 30 feet in, potentially all the way back to the building. It's 100 feet back.
Once again, confusion, though. I thought that the intent of the original plan was to have the building set forward with parking in back, therefore not being viewed by the right-of-way, et cetera.
That's what we were hoping the planning board might want to address at this point.
So the planning board doesn't really care.
They care.
Well,
go ahead.
I was going to say, I thought it said in here that they didn't really have any opinion.
They didn't have an opinion on 15 or 30 feet for the no parking.
But they didn't want to see the building any closer than 100-foot setback.
They don't want to deal with building setbacks until they deal with the entire town center concept. They didn't want to do it in that piecemeal fashion. And I think, you know, we, as chairman of the ordinance committee, I feel that we move things along very quickly to get that kind of consideration before the planning board and get a very quick turnaround and response from them. This has all happened within the last month, and it's not usually
done that quickly. I think we have responded in a very timely fashion to concerns put forward by the ordinance committee that were raised because of our discussions with Mr. Tinsman.
Then another question. What does this actually hope to achieve if the final theory is that the ideal situation for a main street or that type of theme is to have all buildings up front, parking in back? This would seem to
the
take
hope,
that right out of the whole
the hope
picture.
With this is that if you have at least 30 feet, which the hope would be that there would be shrubbery trees and trees on that to screen the parking, that the parking wouldn't be as visually offensive as if it were closer to the road. It's not the ideal solution. A more ideal solution would be to say the parking has to be behind the building.
Another question then. I mean, this is without trying to relate it to anything that is quote-unquote proposed. If a proposee were to approach the planning board with a site plan they determined between now and then that it was best to have the building up front, couldn't the process still continue forward for that proposee to go to the Zoning Board of Appeals and say, I think, no?
Not for the, if you have to meet very specific criteria to get a variance from the Zoning Board, and the lots that I'm aware of where this kind of facility might come about in town would not meet the criteria for that kind of variance. It would have to meet the 100-foot building setback. I wasn't aware of all that when we were looking at setbacks. I was told that there were no lots in town that could meet the 100-foot setback, and therefore they all had to go to the Zoning Board. That's why when I came before the council and workshop last month and said I'd like this to go to Planning Board because of the building setback, because I had been given that new information. So there are instances where lots in the BA zone on Route 77 can meet the 100-foot setback. They don't have good reasons for requesting a variance, and I would strongly doubt they'd get a variance on the building setback.
Other than, isn't part of this also that it should be consistent with other buildings in the same area?
And there's at least one building in the BA zone on Route 77 that's 140 feet back from the road.
But there's several, including this building, that aren't.
The front porch is about 45 feet back.
If this is stipulating here that,
But we're talking about new construction, Carl.
Oh, I know, but if it's trying to stay inconsistent what is now in place, okay, old construction, it's not going to be consistent with that. If you had one at 50, one at 100, one at 20, that's not consistent.
That's right.
So that's confused.
We don't have a good solution right now. You know, another thing to do is to say you don't want to set this to public hearing, you want it to die if you have a good reason.
Or you want it studied first, whatever.
I think that the specific problem that we have, without getting into particular proposals, is that the town planner has been bombarded with not only work, but the request to develop a variety of proposed skeletal ordinances, one of which being a town center story. And probably it would be a fair estimate to suggest that about a year would be necessary to a year to 18 months to really get that kind of ordinance up to the point of being new ordinance language that we would be using as criteria. So I think, you know, rather than tabling issues for 18 months, we're trying to solve that, even though, as you suggest, there is going to be this sawtooth sort of business, I mean, throughout the town center. It's not going to, at the moment, look like a cozy little New England, town center where everything is a la Sturbridge Village.
It never will.
No.
Does that help with your questions?
No, I'm still confused, but
you're
it
still
helps.
It helps. All right, that's a step forward. I think before people get overly excited about this town center concept, they should also realize that the town council itself has not really had any debate or any conceptualizing of what a town center, New England town center, can be. Yes, some of the house, the buildings can be right close to the road, but usually if they are, there are sidewalks. Sometimes the setback is even greater, where you have 40 or 50 feet from the road. So that's going to be an item that will be coming up in the future that will be fun for everyone to participate in. But right now, we need to deal with this type of facility in town. As Mr. Tinsman said, and as the planner has said, there is no language that allows this type of facility at all. There seems to be an interest for this type of facility. Now you have to decide what you want to do. Do we want to change the parking requirement to, did you say 30 or 35 feet?
The no parking to 30. The no parking front setback to 30 feet.
That is one proposal. The other proposal is to send it back to the ordinance committee and have them review it again. Council McLaughlin.
Madam Chairman, since we've heard from all three members of the ordinance committee this evening in consensus that it should be revised to 30 feet, I would like to move that we set to public hearing on April 11th at 7:30. Is it the 11th?
The 8th.
8th, whenever the next meeting is. The draft health facility zone text change, including sections 19.1.3 definitions, 19.3.1 area and frontage of lot, 19.3.5 parking turnarounds, driveway openings, 19.2.4 business district A permitted uses, with the amendment that 19.2.4 sub J sub 2 read, no parking shall be located in the front setback within 30 feet of the right of way.
Second.
Discussion? There being no discussion, all those in favor of setting this for a public hearing next month, our meeting, 7-0. For a short agenda, it certainly is taking a long time. We're only up to item number four, which is item 153, to consider a report of the 1990 deer depredation program and take any necessary action. We have quite an extensive report compiled by Chief Pickering. Do you have anything further you'd like to add? Okay. Comments from counselors? It being the chief's recommendation that this be done privately through landowners with private invitees and the state, not involving the town or the police department in supervision in the future. Do we accept acknowledge acceptance of the report?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor? 7-0. Item number 154, to consider a request from the police department to utilize wet team funds for an equipment storage vehicle and take any necessary action. We have a letter here also from Chief Pickering. The subject is a command van. Would you like to come up to the microphone and just explain for the public why you would like to use some of these special funds for this van?
Certainly. About a year ago, we came to the this council and asked for permission to begin a limited fundraiser to purchase a inflatable boat and also an equipment storage trailer, which we were going to use to put our wet team gear in. As might have been expected, that has stalled to some extent due to, I think, to the economy and several other factors, and due to the fact that it was limited in its scope. We have about $12,000 right now in our fundraising budget, and we are asking that in lieu of this equipment trailer that we had proposed to you last year, that we take $6,000 to be included with $2,500 from another benefactor to purchase a van. It's a 1979 Chevrolet van. The purchase price of that van right now is $5,000. We're asking for the additional monies to retrofit the inside of it, to hang this equipment, also to install some communications equipment that we presently have in our police van, so that it can become a mobile communication center as well as storage for wet team equipment. We've included another $1,000 in that $6,000 request to be used to bring this up to, in terms of mechanical condition. We've had the van over to our town mechanic. He suggested that $1,000 would be necessary to bring it up to snuff in that regard, so we may have to change some springs and do some minor mechanical work to it. In consideration of this, we would be asking also to divest ourselves of the old Ghostbuster van, as it's been called, the old police van. So this is basically exchanging one piece of equipment for another, and that is, in essence, our request.
Essentially, this is not of any cost to your budget. It's all in the special
That's correct.
Fundraising.
Mm-hmm.
And it's is this command van going to be utilized by the police or fire department if there's an emergency situation?
Yes, too? Well, we look to it to be used primarily by the WET team for equipment and response, but it will be multi-purpose and will be used by other public safety entities as well.
Questions? Councilor Jordan?
I like that smile.
Good.
I just want to ask one question, and I'm going to move that you go forward because I think it's an excellent idea, and I think you'll have a much better workable piece of vehicle to work out of. And I suppose after you make your transfers and what have you, the other vehicle could go up for sale?
That's correct. We would certainly propose that.
I'm not going to buy because you say the brakes are froze up already. So.
We'll do some work on it.
And no, but I think it's an excellent idea. And like I say, when you get done, I think we should get rid of the other one and put it up for sale or auction or something.
We'll put it in the main towns and see if some other community.
Something like that, yes. So I will so move that the WET team proceed with their recommendations of purchasing a new vehicle for $5,000 and be able to take, maybe I'm getting this screwed up, I don't know.
No, just, you know, as let
me help you.
As a proposal, then I won't have to read it.
I'll second that motion.
Second.
Further discussion. Councilor Reed.
Do we also authorize the WET team to sell the existing vehicle?
No, I think that should be the town's official duty.
Are we going to delegate the police chief as the agent for the selling?
Or well, I'll delegate the manager as the agent to dispose of the vehicle because I think it's a proper procedure.
Okay. All questions? All in favor? 7-0, Chief.
Thank you.
Item number 155, to consider a request from New England Telephone Company for two pole location on Charles E. Jordan and Fowler Roads and take any necessary action. We have a letter here from Blaine Hopkins, the manager of the right-of-way department. These poles are located on our particular diagram. Is there anything further that needs to be added?
I move that we grant the request for the two poles. One on Fowler Road, one on Charles E. Jordan Road.
Yes.
And I hope every council member knows where the Charles E. Jordan Road is.
Second.
Further questions? All in favor? 7-0. Item number 156, to consider authorizing a quick claim deed to James M. and Mary J. Haskell for land and building situated at 284 Fowler Road on map U43 through 29. And take any necessary action.
Madam Chairman, I'd ask to be excused from voting on this particular issue as Mr. Haskell built my house and it may be perceived as a conflict of interest.
Is there a motion to accept?
So moved.
All
second.
In favor? Councilor Greenland would not participate in this discussion of this item. Mrs. Pizzo, did you want to add anything further to the information that we have here? Everything is up to date, everything's been paid.
Yes, it has. Just very briefly, this was the only 1989 real estate tax lien that lapsed into foreclosure that was due to an error by the mortgage company. I have in my possession a check for $89.90 and 1991 taxes to pay these to date, and the next step would be in order for you folks to authorize the town manager to sign the quick claim deed.
Councilor McLaughlin.
I move that we authorize the town manager to sign the quick claim deed for this item.
So second.
Any discussion? All in favor? 6-0. Next, a citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. Is there anyone who wishes to come forth to make a comment? Are there any items that are not on the agenda that councilors may want to comment on? Councilor Reed?
It's about the agenda, Madam Chairman, that I would like to comment on. I've had more than two people, I can't remember how many, speak to me about televising the town council agenda on cable channel 38 on a monthly basis. And the other question, or the other part of that question was who sets the agenda, and could there be consideration to items such as the appointments committee recommendations, and items where the public might be more interested at 8:30 than at 10:30 at night, if those items could be moved to the front of the agenda. And I didn't know exactly how to address that.
The town manager is responsible for setting the agenda and usually the order. He does try, if we're having public hearings, to have them earlier in the meeting. But I do agree it would be much more convenient for the citizens if appointments committee choices were earlier in the evening. But I think that can be discussed with the manager. And at our community meeting, neighborhood meeting that we had last Wednesday night at the library, it was really encouraging. It was fun to be in an informal situation. We had some very active discussions, and that item was also brought up there, as well as tax issues and budget issues. And for those of you who were there, thank you for coming. And for those who weren't, I hope you'll join us next year. It really is a rewarding experience, I hope, for the citizens. It certainly is for the councilors. If there are no other items that needed to be discussed, I'll take a motion for adjournment, and then we'll go into a budget workshop following.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion? All in favor? Good evening for those of you who are turning us off. The rest of you may observe our budget meeting. We'll take a 5-minute recess.